everybody. Welcome back to 21 Days of Fasting and Prayer. Today, I am joined by our elder in training, Justin Gloyd. Justin is a good friend of mine. And today, we'll be talking about how prayer works. So the title today is Prayer Works, but we're going to kind of get into the nuts and bolts of prayer and how it applies to this time of fasting and prayer and the circumstances we're in with the COVID-19 outbreak. So what's up, Justin?
Hey, what's going on?
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Good, good. It's late at night. You know, we put the kids to bed, and I know that you put your son to bed. So, I'm a little tired, but not worse for the wear. It was a good Shabbat. So today I want to kind of bring to the forefront one of my favorite passages of scripture. It's in 1 Samuel chapter 1. It's about a woman named Hannah, and Hannah is the mother of the prophet Samuel. She is married to a man named Elkanah, and he has another wife who's unnamed, and the other wife is the one having the children, and she's not. So the other wife is always making fun of her, and, you know, to the point where Hannah feels bitter. So what Hannah does is she goes into the tabernacle and kind of unloads in a way that's not normal. I mean, the high priest Eli looked at her and thought that she was drunk. And she goes in, and it says in verse 12, that she prayed long before Adonai, and Eli, the priest, was watching her mouth. Now Hannah was praying in her heart, only her lips were moving, but her voice could not be heard. So Eli thought she was drunk, and Eli said to her, "How long will you be drunk? Get rid of your wine." But in response, Hannah said, "No, my lord, I'm a woman with an oppressed spirit. I haven't been drinking wine or beer. Instead, I've been pouring out my soul before Adonai. Don't consider your handmaiden a wicked woman. For out of my great anguish and grief, I've been praying until now." And Eli says, "Okay, go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant the petition that you asked of him." So she leaves and goes out. And, you know, time goes by, and God answers her prayer and gives her a son, Samuel. And what she winds up doing with Samuel was making a vow to the Lord to say, "Okay, you know what? Like, as soon as he's old enough to be on his own, I'm going to send him back to serve in the tabernacle with Eli." And, you know, that's pretty much the beginning of the story of the prophet Samuel. But it doesn't happen without Hannah. So, Justin, what does that kind of that prayer look like to you? So when you read that, or when you're looking at that, and this woman's so engrossed and emotional in prayer, what does that stir up in you? What kind of response does that stir up in you?
Well, it's like just really big part of that to me is just how she didn't really have the right words to say. In fact, she had no words to say at all. I just think it's really cool that, one, that God understood, even though she wasn't actually verbalizing anything. And he understood her heart. He understood what she was thinking, what she needed, what she wanted. And she really didn't have to know the right thing to do or the right thing to say, which I think just when you go to a typical prayer circle, you'll pick up on patterns when people pray together, that there's like a lingo or like a language that goes around, and
Father God, Daddy God, Father God, Daddy God, and it can vary.
It can be like Lord of the Rings elvish formality, or it could be like like you were saying, like where they just repeat a lot of things. But there's kind of this unsaid, almost want to say like an unsaid oppression on how an individual can pray. And it really comes down to just that connection between you and the Lord. And there are times where you know exactly what to say. There's some times where you will probably say more than you should. and there are times where you just don't have anything. But I think the point is that, you know, God just really thinks it's the important thing is coming to him and just kind of unloading and then just being open to take what he has to give as either a response or sometimes he doesn't respond. It's kind of a twofold thing. You don't have to say anything and neither does he. But I think it's really cool in that story that she came in, she prayed the only way she could. She was given a rough time for it by a priest of all people. And then she explained like just how it is. Like, my heart is just too heavy. I'm just here to pray. And finally he backed off. And then at the end of that chapter or that section, you know, God completely understood anyway. And
right.
It didn't matter. It didn't matter how she worded things. It didn't matter how she presented herself in front of other people and how she carried herself when she prayed. She was at the temple. She was in front of a priest. If there's ever a time to be worried about how you look or what you're saying when you pray, that would be it.
He's totally judging me right now, but I have to do this.
Yeah. but it didn't matter. And some people, I think, are afraid. I know I kind of grew up having this weird sense of shame if I prayed the way that I wanted to.
Right.
Or if I really felt like I was praying for a lot of specific things that I needed answered or, you know, didn't know what to do about. And I would just be like, oh man, I'm praying an awful lot about things. I shouldn't be so selfish. I shouldn't be, you know, so honest. This is kind of disrespectful. And it's like, there's this lingering feeling of guilt with that. And it's kind of honky because it's just,
that's the key word. You just said it right there. It's honesty with God. It's, you know, he knows it all anyway. Like, he sees into our minds and our hearts, and he sees our emotions, and he can explain stuff to us about our stuff that we can't even see about ourselves. We can't even fathom about ourselves. He knew it when he created us, and he knows it, you know, in every step and every breath you take. Sorry, I can't say it, but you know what I'm saying. You know, one thing that strikes me about the idea of formal prayer, so I was raised Muslim, and I watched these guys who were Muslim and they were praying, and, you know, they would act like so, I mean, I'm not denigrating Muslims, you know what I mean? This isn't the point. The point is how I was raised, right? Like formality. And this story gets better, so just wait for part two of it. You know, I was raised around people who prayed formally, but then, you know, the minute that the prayer was over, they'd be bad mouthing people, you know, they'd be saying bad things about each other, you know, behind their backs as soon as people left the room. You know, they thought I didn't know Turkish, so I would hear what they were saying about each other when they left, you know. And I said, I don't want any part of that. And then I went to Catholic school, you know, which is weird, right? That book is coming out one day, I promise you. I went to Catholic school and it was so, you know, oppressive. I mean, it was, and I'm not denigrating Catholics either. This is all talking about for me, right? Like what I was looking for. And in my journey, you know, back and forth and then going into Messianic Judaism and understanding that there's a role for liturgical prayer. And some of those things speak to me every day. And, you know, there isn't a day that goes by sometimes that I'm not reciting part of the Amidah because it's just stuck in my head. An old and ancient prayer, but the truth is prayer works when I'm honest.
Yeah.
Prayer works when I'm upfront and, you know, if I'm having a bad day, I tell God I'm having a bad day.
Mm-hmm.
And it's almost like, yeah, I know.
Yeah, totally. What's so funny is what you're saying about the liturgical thing is, you know, I don't want to make it sound like I don't think formal prayers are no good. In fact, one thing that I've noticed just personally for me is the closer I am when I'm with the better I'm doing in consistent prayer and the more honest I'm being when we do those traditional prayers and stuff, it'll actually hit heavier because I'll be like, "Ooh, I know what they're talking about." Right. Yeah, and it strikes a little harder to me when things are more honest, just in the private life, and then when you bring that into, you know, like a religious or like a congregational setting, it seems to kind of add authenticity to those liturgical prayers. Because it just makes sense. You're like, oh yeah. And usually I get kicked in the pants right with whatever prayer just happens to be the prayer we're doing at the time. Like if it's a holy day or you know, an event like that, you know, just special prayers for special times. And those usually end up tying up with whatever I'm dealing with personally too. So,
right. I gotta, you know, there are going to be people who are watching these, hopefully, that, you know, are looking at us going, I'm not a believer and I don't really know what talking to God is like. And, you know, on top of that, they're going through some crazy stuff right now with what's going on in the world. Like, I honestly feel like I haven't left my house for 2 months. I mean, I have, but it feels like I haven't, you know? Yeah. And I'm walking here with my 6 kids and my temper's short and, you know, it's starting to get hot in the house. And, you know, the last thing I want to do sometimes is really just say what's on my mind to God. So, like, what encouragement would you give to somebody who either doesn't, you know, really have, like, an open communication with God or, you know, somebody who maybe did once a long time ago, but it's kind of stalled or gotten stale.
Read anything by David or Job. they don't hold back when they're not feeling it. Especially Job, you know, he gets to the point where he's like, I wish I was never born, and all sorts of stuff like that. And I think there's nothing wrong with that. I think that's encouraged. If you're mad, you know, and you don't understand what God is up to, you know, tell him, I think you're not being very cool about this.
Right.
I don't think he's afraid of you. So, don't be afraid, to just speak your mind. If you think something's not fair, just say, this isn't fair. Just be ready for a smackdown though.
Right. Job
and David both, you know, right. their lamenting usually ends with God going, all right, listen up. and then everything kind of makes sense and you kind of are reminded of your place a little bit. But I think it's the two-way street of prayer is, you know, you get to say what you need to say, but he also right. gets to and say what he needs to say.
Certainly reserves the right to speak back. Right. you know, yeah, that's great. I really love that. Some of my favorite, you know, or most memorable, let's not say my favorite, some of my most memorable times of prayer have been based around the idea of, well, I don't want to.
Yeah.
I don't want to do that.
I mean, I won't lie, there's times where I start my prayers with, like, I don't really want to do this.
Yeah. No, and I mean, listen, that's important because the hard part is right now, you know, there's really no great motivation for a lot of people to just kind of take that step out because – honestly, if you believe that there's a God, you're wondering why he's doing this, why we're all locked up. And, you know, if you don't believe that there's a God, you're thinking, how could there possibly be a God who allows these things to happen and these people to get sick and, you know, all these people to lose their jobs? You know, that's a, you know, video for another day. But the truth of it is, you know, what I want to get across to everyone is listening and what some of the things that Justin has said, when we are real in prayer, it works because prayer works.
Yeah.
I want to close this out. Maybe Justin, you can pray for us for a sec and then we'll close this time out.
Sure. Lord, thank you for this time. Thank you for giving us a way to share with our congregation and just anyone, even while we're all locked up in our houses. And we just want to pray that during these 21 days, as we go down closer to Shavuot, that you just kind of show us some cool stuff. Just give us some really interesting things. Help us to remind us to listen, and just keep bugging us until we do. And we just thank you for this time of the year. And the world still turns, so we are thankful for that. And we just want to pray that everyone gets back to normal soon, and things work out well. And we just want you to let everybody know that they are remembered and that they are loved. Amen.
Amen. All right, everybody. We'll see you next time.
Bye.